urgency, and I think from that they've started probably getting the idea that, like, okay, well, there's the opportunity to record the tape, like Paul's mentioning, because it's, they're not, you know, these are songs, and then it's a rare, it's a harder thing in this day and age, or it's a rarer thing, I should say, that bands do this, because it's a harder route, it's a lot easier to do things digitally, but I think he saw the opportunity to do this, so, and it was a good challenge for all of us, because it's, we've always done portions of our records to tape, but after a while you want to go to digital just to make it a little bit easier to do as many guitar overdubs and not stress, and it's more economical. But if you do things to tape, it actually limits you, meaning you have to, you only have one or two guitar takes because there's only so much space. And it was a good challenge for us, but it provided us with the realm of creating this really lively, urgent record, and sort of reinforced us being like a good, tight, you know, live band. So these songs really have a presence to them, and they really are captured, you know, as per Dave's great skill, in a very short amount of time. And, you know, his studio was a really tremendous experience for me. And then we also really let him into the process and let him have the last word on things, and, you know, and that was a really great experience.
No, that was great.
If you want to be my head man, just
that was good. Well done.
Yeah.
Bravo.
Thank you.
Okay, talking about the construction of the songs and of the lyrics, I saw an interview with Rolling Stones where you talked about how you conceive songs as fragments, as if it were an abstract piece of art. Is it still like that? Are you still constructing it like that?
Lyrically?
Yeah. And yes, of course.
I guess so. I don't remember using that term fragments, but I think that sounds about right. I think the first seed of an idea comes in that form, generally. You know, it'll be like just a spontaneous lyric, or you know, maybe first the melody, and then something will just occur to me, and that is the seed from which all the rest of the song can kind of grow. And yeah, I guess it does sort of feel like it's the fragment of a thought, and then I don't actually even have to articulate the whole thought, because somehow it's evoked in the final, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense, I get it. Okay, so you've been focused again in New York, and I want to know how it's been the experience of being part of the book Meet Me in the Bathroom by Lizzie Goodman. How was that experience?
I didn't remember a lot of it. I had to read it to kind of recall what was going on.
You read the book?
I read through it.
You read the book.
How was it?
It was interesting to read about what you were a part of and what you were doing back then. Because at the time, you know, there was obviously a lot going on, and a lot of our friends were, you know, in bands that were, you know, bubbling under, you know, putting out records, and the next thing you know, all your friends are gone because you're touring the world, you know, and you're meeting each other, you know, in Tokyo. You haven't seen each other in a couple of years, and you have to see each other on the road. So there was this kind of this feeling that I had to, like, kind of summarize, like, through that book, I was able to summarize certain things that kind of transpired in New York City. In the bathroom, essentially.
But and the process of the book, like, how was it with Lizzie? How was the relationship, and how she constructed all this puzzle?
It's pretty seamless. I mean, it was kind of an interview form, but in such a way that it wasn't like Q&A. You know, it was like there was a question that, if you were going to give an answer, it couldn't be like, well, this happened, period. You know, you had to expand on it and kind of thought about your mood and what was going on at that time. And the way she kind of extracted that was pretty amazing, I think.
It's also like, I did my interview like a really long time before the book came out, and she's a friend, so it was more just like a conversation, and it was a good conversation, one that I hadn't really thought about until that moment. But because we already knew each other, there was that comfort and ease of just sharing. But then I didn't think about the fact that this was destined to be in a book for until it came out, and then I certainly wasn't expecting that many people to really have that interest in such a subject. And then, you know, people have asked questions in interviews like in Japan about the book, or held up a version of the book while in Japan and things like that. I didn't think there'd be this curiosity about that time period. So it's I haven't read the book, so I don't know like how it turned out, but it's certainly been interesting to see people's like interest in that, in that, you know, that time period.
For me, it's quite amazing because I think it was a very important part of music history, and you were part of it. So you gotta feel very proud of it, okay? you gotta be aware of it.
Nice take on it.
Yeah.
I mean, I did get the feeling, because she's also a friend, and I remember we did a few interviews over the span of a couple of years, and I did have a sense that I think if anybody could do this sort of book, that she would be a great, you know, that she'd be perfect for it, and that her work would probably be the one that defined that moment in time, because she's, you know, very talented.
She was invested.
Yeah.
Okay, so talking about the venues that you've played, how does it feel, you know, to have all this checklist of venues that are the dreamed venues of all bands, you know, all musicians? Talking about Madison Square Garden, Hollywood Bowl, Royal Albert Hall, Sydney Opera House, Mexico City, you know, how does it feel?
pretty amazing, really. You know, it's you try not to, at least from my perspective, you try not to focus on, you know, the grandeur of the whole thing until the show's over. You can get sucked up into the space easily. It's the first time we played Radio City, I found it very intimidating. Because that's just a place that you know, if my grandmother was still alive, I can say, hey, we played Radio City, and she'd be like, oh, wow, man, now you're doing something. So just that whole, you know, the legend of a place, you know, it holds a lot of weight, you know. And it's always better to look at the stuff in hindsight. And it's, yeah, it's Sydney Opera House and Royal Albert Hall and Madison Square Garden.
It sounds great in a list.
It does.
It was a great list.
And especially the ones that you just listed. I mean, that was from like October until, you know, it's been like the last 5 months or so. So yes. That's pretty incredible.
Good job.
No, I know, it feels amazing. That's great. Thanks for pointing that out.
Okay, so given that when the band formed, there was an evident influence of grunge sound and Nirvana in particular, how does it feel to play a concert on the 25th anniversary of Kurt's death? Because it's going to be tomorrow.
I mean, I chose this career as my, like, you know, life path as a result of, you know, Nirvana was the inspiration for me. Like, very clearly that band was kind of the one that ignited the passion for me. So it's a, yeah, I hadn't really thought about the anniversary of his death, but I mean, it's, yeah, it'd be nice to play, consider it in his honor.
It's a great casualty, no? Like, does it mean something
it's
else,
also,
you know?
Great.
Like,
yeah, he was, yeah, totally.
You didn't thought about it, right?
Like, I usually don't keep track of people's death.
Death day, I don't, yeah, don't. No.
I was waiting for John Lennon's right? anniversary. Sorry, Kurt.
Great coincidence, I'm gonna say. Okay, so how do you foresee the experience of playing in London with the Strokes on May?
There's another band that's is it the Raconteurs?
Yeah. There's a lot of bands.
Yeah, it's a really
bill.
Cool rock bill.
Wow.
I'm excited about that show.
Oh
yeah.
My God. How is it gonna be like? Is it gonna be like a reunion or something like that?
We didn't in the early days ever play with them. I don't think.
No, we didn't.
But
we weren't
friends
like.
Or something.
Well, in the early days, we weren't friends either. When we were all coming up, I didn't know
we
any of those
know
guys.
Them.
Yeah,
we didn't know
just
each
never
other.
Bumped into each other. Yeah, along over the years, we have now.
Okay.
Yeah, they're super cool dudes.
And what do you expect of that?
Their shows are
show.
Super tight. They're you know, their songs are amazing and they play them brilliantly. It's, you know, always fun to watch the Strokes.
Okay.
Sorry, Sam, what were you?
No.
It's
Okay, this is the a cheesy one, okay? But I have to ask. If we had a time machine and you go 20 years back, what would you say to yourselves starting Interpol?
I would throw away a lot of clothes.
The white belt?
Out. Maybe a white belt would be gone. A couple things along the way.
Oh, man, the white belt was tight, man.
Yeah.
It's true, man. Keep your colors.
Wasn't there white shoes?
Well, white shoes are okay. Yeah. That's fine. The white belt, I can't stand behind that.
And you guys?
I don't know. I think it's just, I think I would have great disbelief in hearing that we are going to play tomorrow in Colombia again. And that would have been like, no way, because just 20 years ago, I mean, for the first 5 years, it didn't seem like we were ever going to get signed or put out a record, and, you know, no one was interested in us, and it was very much like just, you know, batting around New York City, playing show after show, not, you know, no one signing us or showing much interest or more people coming to our gig. So in that sense, it was just trying to make it to the moment where we have the opportunity to make a record, and that was just like the goal. So anything after that just would have been unimaginable, you know, let alone the opportunity to kind of make several records and tour the world quite a few times and all to play all those venues that you listed. So I think I would have had great disbelief on that possibility, that notion. But but it's good to like kind of think about these things and have that perspective, because you know it's very easy just to kind of move forward and get caught up in the every single day movement, but then not to have that perspective of looking back and being like, this is an incredible opportunity and privilege, and it's incredible to have all these, you know, people actually interested in your music in general, let alone in, you know, various parts of the world.
Yeah, I think at the time too, I mean, getting signed to Matador Records was enough. I mean, I discovered Matador in 1990 or so, when they put out a Superchunk 7-inch single or something. And I always liked the whole aesthetic, their whole approach to releasing records and the type of bands and how eclectic they were. The Matador sound was kind of not one singer or third lead singer.
All.
Someone's like gonna remix it. Bring it right back.
So I think. Oh.
You want this one?
So I think just after, you know, signing to Matador Records was enough to go, you know, savor this. It's probably not going to last that long, and here we are. But it's still, I think we kind of still maintain that grounded attitude, you know, aside from where we've been and what we're doing. You know, I'm going to be coy about this, you know, there's a reason why we're here, but aside from that, it's still like day by day, you know, kind of just only go as far as you can see. Don't make any plans that you really can't manage or follow through with.
No, and I can sense it. You're very
just pragmatic approach.
Yeah, on your feet, you know. Mm-hmm. I really love that. I have to say. Mm-hmm. You want to add something?
Nope.
Besides the clothing?
Yeah, enough.
Nothing else.
That's it.
Okay. Okay, and the last question, so we can start sharing with the press. Well, you've been this band where you started when globalization and all that stuff, mediatic craziness, wasn't there, you know. And now you are there, you know, in this context. So how do you feel it has changed the way of making art, and it has changed the industry, and how it has affected you?
Are we talking kind of social media, kind of?
Yeah, internet, you know, internet connect everything.
I mean, I think, I don't know, man.
How's changed us?
You, and if you want to say,
Something about the industry and you know, like the creation of art itself.
I don't think it's changed us how we go about our process so much. I think we still kind of only can create things by reaction off of each other, which is true to the early days, and starts from that, you know. And so it's still like that. I think doesn't matter what's happening in the times, you know. It's still us in a room trying to do things. That's the way at least it initiates. I think apart from that, on the scale of how like the music industry and how, you know, the media's changed, and it's impossible to ignore that these are things you have to kind of roll with. But I don't think we do try to do things that don't feel natural to us and feel okay with us. You know, we don't try to force things, or I don't think we try to guess on this should work. It has to sort of still feel kind of inherently compatible, you know. But at the same time, it's you know, the times are very different than they were when we put out Turn On the Bright Lights, you know. And social media was not a thing even then, and the way people discover music, listen to music,
yeah,
it's
yes.
gone through so many cycle forms that it's, you know, you have to keep rolling with that and be and go with that and look at, I think, more the fact that it's actually quite exciting versus being like, you know, lamenting the old ways. Being music can reach people all over the world, and, you know, no one is sort of left out because they live in a remote location. And I think that's great. That's there's neat, you know, egalitarian aspect to that I'm pro, like I'm really into it. But yeah, I think it's good to be flexible and kind of old and be excited by the times, but do things that feel correct to you.
I mean, I think in the age now of like SoundCloud and Spotify and just sort of playlists that, and all the new ways that people can discover music and have access to it, I still experience music as records. So for me, it's kind of, there's all this new stuff, but then I'm still just looking for like a record that I'm gonna dig into by an artist that I'm interested in. So I don't know, it feels to me kind of fundamentally the same experience too. But yeah, it's a pretty crazy time.
Well, everyone can be famous nowadays, you know, like,
yeah,
instantly.
Yeah, it really is true. I mean, anything can, you can, very drastic things can happen overnight to a person's career, you know. It's crazy, it's a crazy time. Anyway,
okay,
it's a
so
whole other conversation.
It was deep, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
We almost went there, but we shouldn't.
Okay. Well, thank you for your time, for
thank
everything.
You.
And we're going to start doing the questions with the press. So Eugene is going to take it from here.
Hi, guys.
Hi there.
I'm going to help translate for the ones who not speak English. I believe you speak well, very well Spanish.
A little bit.
Chicos,
entonces empezamos con las preguntas. Por favor, una pregunta por medio. Y si necesitan traducción de sus preguntas, me gusta, me avisan. El primero en lista es Alejandro Urilla, de Francis.
Hi, guys. Welcome again to Colombia. It's a pleasure to have Interpol at the Stereo Picnic Fest. You said at the beginning, you play a couple of years ago your first album, Turn Off the Bright Light Again. This is not a common decision for the bands, because the bands always focus on the new material and their evolution. So you guys decide to watch in that mirror again to discover your first album without Carlos, now with David at bass. So my question is about that experience, playing again your first album, and how it affected, influenced your new album, Bernardo.
Well, it was great to go out and play the first album after 15 years from start to finish. Just to go back and revisit something, you know, that you did a long time ago that people were really excited, as if it was, if it had just came out. The show of support for that is incredible. And, you know, it was definitely worth it to go out, you know, kind of take the invitation and you know, go on tour for a month throughout Europe to do that. I think in terms of how it affected the recording process of Marauder, it was just, we were playing live. You know, first we were in the studio, we took a break from recording in upstate New York, and then went out and played Bright Lights in its entirety. And we took that energy that just, regardless of it being Bright Lights or not, just the energy of playing live and having fun and it not being a laborious event, made us, it just took all this fuel back to the process of making a record. And we've never done anything like that. You know, we're very, very methodical in the way we've done things over the years, and like
recording doesn't mix with playing live. You know, like, no, we are in the studio, don't ask us to do any shows, that's ridiculous. And to kind of break from that and have it work was a great, great experience.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Some critics have been kind of harsh with your last album, and now you're releasing this new EP. Do you think album reviews are still relevant in this digital environment? How do you feel about album reviews nowadays?
I mean, I think they're as relevant as ever, but at the same time, I feel like they don't always really impact whether anybody's going to listen or not listen to something, or enjoy it or not listen, not enjoy it. And I kind of feel like some of the criticism that I read on this record, to me, were like criticism of the exact things that I think make it a great record. And that made me sort of feel like we're all hearing the same thing, and you know, I think it's awesome. So it's sort of not a criticism that bothered me in any way, if that makes sense.
I haven't read reviews in forever. I think you write music because you need to write music, and you release music, or you say it as a song or an album's finished because we feel like it's finished and we're comfortable releasing it out there. Once it's out there, it's up to anyone to gather their own opinion, how they feel that one way or the other. But I think for us, it's like we wouldn't put it out there unless we had that comfort and that security that, you know, we're proud of it and we feel like this is the next chapter of what we want to say. And so with that, I don't think too much beyond that, because you can't control those elements. So I don't know. This is, you know, it's part of being a little bit vulnerable and putting things out there and letting things go, but it doesn't really impact me or I think too much about it.
Thank you.
Gonna read the next question. Pregunta via Primo, Carita, and this question is basically if you are interested in any type of form of music, or I mean, if there's any artist you like, Latin American artists you like.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I thought Mala Rodriguez was from Latin America, but she's from Spain, right?
Yeah, half of it.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't think of one right now. Oh, I mean, the last time that we played here, there was the band El Mato Policía Moto Risa, and they were amazing. That was a great, great show, and I just heard that they're doing very well down here, so glad. I was very impressed. Remember them? Amazing singer. It was really epic.
I know right now.
So there's one.
Thank you. ¿Alguien más? ¿Preguntas? Ah, Ignacio Mayorga de 120.
So I've heard that Paul was into hip hop when the band first formed, and nowadays the influence of hip-hop in the U.S. charts is pretty dominant, right? So what can rock music or rock as a scene can learn from the hip-hop predominance, and what are the lessons that these guys are giving to us rockers? And if this whole genre labeling does still make sense nowadays?
Huh, that's really interesting. I think, yeah, the labeling makes sense, because I think rock is rock and hip-hop is hip-hop. And I don't really know what, if anything, anybody needs to learn from, you know, any other genre. I think I feel like there's some, the new thing in hip-hop seems to be like guys that grew up kind of digging rock. Like there's like some rappers that were into sort of emo rock, and My Chemical Romance and stuff on the way up. And that's really fascinating to me now that very prominent hip-hop artists are referencing rock. But as far as like, should a rock band take anything from hip-hop, I mean, mean, if they want to, you know, but nothing, there's no recipe outside of inspiration, I think. And rock is great, like live instruments, and the live experience of rock music, I think, is a very unique and special thing that sort of is always going to be compelling to people, whether or not it's the prominent genre on the charts. I think you can always come back to, I think rock could always return as the main one, main mainstream genre someday. I'm super monotone right now.
Paola from Shark.
Hi guys, so this EP is more sort of like a more like party type. Why did you decide to go to sort of a different direction from your previous work?
I just think these songs worked well together. But I don't think we didn't really decide to like write party songs. I think that when we were working on all this music, they kind of just sort of, you know, felt right as a collective. And I think that the result is that it's sort of upbeat kind of. But yeah, these things just happen. We didn't strategize it in advance. We knew we wanted to make an EP, but we didn't have a concept for the EP in advance. It just worked out that way.
She's asking if you think music nowadays still has the capacity and the power to move people and inspire people. I mean, like in, back in the day. Okay, and if you feel there's any future like encouragement from the new generations to, or there's like no way out. I mean, I believe in la música popular y el rock. In your type of music or in general music, that's
kind of the question. I think so. Yeah, I think it's a kind of thing. I mean, it depends on the individual, like how you regard music and how. What's going on in your life, but I think music, regardless of how it's made, whether it's rock and roll, hip hop, pop, whatever, it can hit someone, reach someone in a way that, you know, it's hard to articulate into words. It's one of those things that, like, humans react to music and in a way that's, it's kind of inexplicable, but sometimes it's sort of a bit of a savior, and it kind of, when you're like a teenager especially, I think it's that sort of, it kind of comforts you and it can guide you through, and I don't think that has to do with the times. Maybe like the type of music may change with the times, but ultimately that feeling, that reaction that you might have with music is something that is timeless, you know. And it's I don't think there's that many things in this world that exist that can intoxicate you like music. So whether it's rock and roll or not, I don't think it matters. I think it's just it, rock and roll still has that potential 50 years, I think, from now to hit someone. It really depends from how it connects you emotionally, you know, but ultimately I think music will always have that path for individuals, for sure.
I think too that I fully agree with Daniel, and I think in this day and age where your choices are so readily available and so far and wide, that when you do connect with something, it becomes even more intense than it would have been 15 years ago, perhaps, because things were more direct. You had your path. You go to your record store, you talk to your friends, and you know, you seek out what you think you might be interested in. And in this day and age, I find that there's just so much available at one time that something comes out of nowhere and it strikes me. It's just like, I didn't expect that, and now I'm floored by that vocal or whatever. It could be rock band or hip hop or R&B or whatever. So it's still for me, it seems even more intense when I can fully connect with something.
Now, I'm going to ask on behalf of Blue Radio over there, Joanna.
Hi.
And she wants to know about how you managed to celebrate your anniversaries. I mean, when you came into the scene, you were very disruptive, but it's been almost like 20 years now or something that you know, you have a career now. And I mean, how's celebrating, you know, a discography, you know, a body of work like yours, and keeping it, you know, up to date in how you feel with the passing of time?
That's a good one. That's a tough one.
Don't think about it too much. Just kind of more. You can answer.
No.
I mean, if we're gonna look at like the anniversary record thing as a way to frame or to look at that, I think it is, and also he kind of mentioned that as well. I think it is sort of a thing right now. I feel like there's a few bands that are doing kind of going back and playing down a whole record. I think it's kind of cool actually. And I feel like it wasn't always done regularly, but it seems like it's becoming something that artists are doing regularly. I remember I saw Trans Am do Future World that way years ago, and that was awesome. You know what I mean? It's a really fun way to experience a band you love is playing one of your favorite records.
There was that whole Don't Look Back series.
Yeah.
That was, you know.
I think they kind of started the whole thing, like Bell and Sebastian, you know.
Sonic Youth.
And, yeah.
Built to Spill. To me, that was like, whoa, are you kidding? This is great. Yeah, I want to go see. And being in bands for so long, like playing your new material off a record, like you're definitely going to sequence it much differently as a show. And then to go see this presentation of like, I'm going to go watch the album tonight. I think that's pretty interesting. There's some people who are just like, that's too revivalist or whatever, some negative connotations. It's like, you fucking listen to the record over and over again. Why not go watch it once? In, you know, 10 years or whatever.
But I'm not entirely sure we're actually answering.
I think
we
might be going way off.
Yeah.
No, but it's way too good answer.
But I think it's also like, you know, when we did do the Bright Lights thing, it was because we were so deep into writing Marauder that when the idea came up, it felt like rather than overthink it, everyone sort of reacted like, that sounds like something fun to do, and like Sam saying, something we've never done to do to interrupt the writing process so close to recording to go do something else completely separate that a record that we made 15 years prior. But it was kind of a healthy thing just to go out, put those new songs aside, pretty close to being complete, to pick up like, you know, this old record and go out there and then try to kind of perform this album and make people feel like they're getting the experience that they wanted. And that was actually almost more daunting than just doing a regular concert, because it's hard to sort of present something like that and make sure people, it's kind of like, you know, there's a certain anticipation people are having for this sort of experience, but it's not so sure you can sort of meet that experience, their expectations. But it was really great to see, you know, like young kids in the audience, like teenagers who were might not, you know, barely born when that record came out, and then people who were probably in the audience when that record did come out. It was great to see how the record sort of found like a new audience over the years. But then for us, I think we were very invested into preparing to record the songs that would go on Marauder and so forth, that it was kind of just like when we picked up that pen and continued on that path, I think we were sort of more focused on what we were doing at present as far as writing. And I still think in those terms more. When I think about what we're doing, I don't look back so much. As I think right now, you know, about the EP, and I think about Marauder, and I'm very proud of both those. And I think those speak to where we're at currently. And yeah.
Thank you.
Juan Ramirez is going to ask.
Hi guys. Well, you just mentioned this sort of thing with emo rappers. And you did this project with Arza, Banks and Steels, which is a very interesting project. I don't know if you heard, but there are some bands that sort of like mix shoegaze and with black metal. So now that we have this sort of unexpected experiments, I wanted to know how you feel about the potential of this sort of projects, and particularly about the result you had with Banks and Steels.
I mean, I think, check one, two. Am I gone now?
Check one, two, down to one mic. I mean, I think kind of like fusion stuff has probably always been there. Shoegaze and metal sounds fucking awesome. Yeah, I mean, I think if it's inspired, it will work on some level to some people, and that's sort of how the Banks and Steels project felt to me. Sort of, it was an organic. It was easy to write those songs. which I think is always kind of a good sign that something has an authenticity to it and like a reason to be. I think if you force things and it's probably not right, but anything that kind of just happens and works and feels good, whatever kind of fusion, I think it's cool. And maybe there will be more of it now because of the way that everybody can experience all kinds of music at any moment and just have really diverse, you know, probably more diverse interests nowadays than ever before because of what's available to people. Maybe we'll see a bunch more. Our sound guy was just talking about Danger Mouse and Karen L's record and said that that's really incredible. I haven't heard that yet.
It does sound amazing.
Does that answer your question?
Thank you, guys.
Hi, I'm Alejandro Nino from Vientos de Rock. I want to ask why Mexico City, like something as iconic as an album cover, like you can choose to like show it in Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, but to show it like in a complete, a big wall in the center of Mexico City.
Just seemed like a pretty cool idea, basically. And you know, Mexico City is an incredible city. We also like the idea of, you're talking about like announcement of the record, or are you talking about the fact that, was that the first?
The fact that something as iconic as the cover was showed like, you know, wall, like in the old days.
Where we announced the record. That's where we revealed the artwork.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was all tied in with the press conference that we did in Mexico City, and I think the reason why we did that is because I think we feel at home in a lot of places around the world, and I think Mexico City is just it's a special place for us with a special public, and it was just cool, I think, to kind of like hark back to old days of press conferences, and then you can do it like in Paris, or you could do it in New York City, or LA, or Bogota, or Mexico City. So I think it just felt like an original and fun thing to do and sort of evocative of kind of older times of, you know, the way things were done.
Okay, that's a wrap. Thank
you
so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.